Chapter 1. Mineral Deficiency, the Disease of the 21st Century. What is supermineral water? As a physician, the number of cancer patients I have examined stretches easily into the thousands. Using appropriate treatments and all conceivable means possible, we doctors have tried to beat cancer, our deadly foe. There is no definitive way to cure cancer. Improvements can be made, but to cure patients of cancer has been difficult, to say the least. Is it right, as a doctor, to accept this current state of hopeless affairs? For me, it was impossible to go on without embracing this question. Not wanting to just sit and wait for the development of a new drug, and even among health foods which are on the market today, I have continued to look for something that will enhance the effectiveness of treatments. It was 10 years or so ago, while researching the effectiveness of anti-cancer drugs, I noticed that up until that point, all researchers had been targeting on organic matters deriving from plants and animals, while completely ignoring inorganic matter such as metals, salts, and water. When considering inorganic matters which the body cannot do without, minerals were the first to come to mind. Included in the generic term minerals are the basic elements such as calcium, sodium, magnesium, etc., which are recognized as essential nutrients. In addition to them, there are also minerals which are used only in tiny amounts inside the body, but whose usefulness had been made clear. This is where I have decided to pay more attention. There are various kinds of minerals among them. Minerals such as tungsten, titanium, and vanadium differ from toxic minerals like mercury and cadmium, and at the same time as being non-toxic, each possesses its own characteristic function. However, in order to be absorbed by the body, it is essential that the mineral be dissolvable. Thus, the search began for minerals processed into a form where it can be completely and easily absorbed by the body. Following an exhaustive search through testing and elimination, the one that finally made it was an ionized solution containing natural minerals, including metallic minerals. I name this solution Super Mineral Water. I will touch upon the miraculous effects of this super mineral water in later chapters, but let us consider modern-day diseases and the environment that surrounds us first. And here there is a chart titled Analysis of Components in Supermineral Water Before Dilution. You can see this chart if you refer to the information that came with the email for your book. Mineral deficiencies have propagated modern-day diseases. It takes a great deal of imagination to try to see a world without diseases. The phenomenon of diseases itself, as well as people becoming sick from diseases, is essentially an unusual situation, yet we have not noticed that we humans seem to have resigned ourselves to the present propagation of modern-day diseases. In truth, a world that is like a dream is unfolding before your very eyes. It may not be easy to believe, but you are approaching an era when cancer, diabetes, cardiac infarction, and atopy can be treated with certainty by trace elements of supermineral water, the world in which doctors will no longer be necessary. Most of the diseases which have caused modern man so much worry and suffering have been brought about because of mineral deficiencies. Here, I should point out that what I call minerals are not minerals in the conventional sense of the word, but rather such trace mineral elements as iron, zinc, copper, manganese, tin, nickel, and cobalt. In plain words, those minerals which the body needed to ensure the correct functioning of its genes had been greatly lacking in modern man, particularly in the populations among developed countries. That is to say that mineral malnutrition has been caused in our body because we continue to eat inorganic crops, which have been subjected to agricultural chemicals and chemical fertilizers. We have become mineral deficient because we eat crops which do not contain enough minerals. Modern-day diseases can be conquered. If the cause can be located, then obviously cancer can be cured. If the cause is understood and prevention becomes possible, then it naturally follows that diseases can be reduced. Even if problems such as traffic accidents and infectious diseases remain a slight worry, most of the diseases which trouble modern man will go on to be perfectly eliminated. Would it be going too far to say that in the near future, modern-day diseases will become extremely rare? Or that the first time a person gets sick will be when they are over 80 years old? What are now labeled as lifestyle illnesses were, not long ago, referred to as adult illnesses, yet they are not necessarily linked to lifestyle, neither are they illnesses which we contract after we become an adult. Those adult illnesses may make their debut later in our lives as prevalent in old people because of their age, but not among young adults to whom these illnesses will become rare. The future is truly bright. However, in reality, something worrisome is taking place now. The fact that neither scientists nor we understood this reality is a terrible situation. What was the reason that drove our medical science towards this mistaken direction? Most of the medical and surgical methods of treatment, including the unnecessary development of cancer surgery and anti-cancer agents, the medicines for treating diabetes, the medicines of treating heart disease, which were all considered brilliant advances and took vast amounts of both taxpayers' money and manpower, have been completely meaningless. The damage and loss from them are incalculable. Modern-day diseases mean malnutrition of minerals. Modern-day diseases are nothing more than the result of defective goods, that is, the mineral-deficient crops, which are produced with today's farming techniques. If this problem were put right, then dealing with the after-effects of the collapse of the bubble economy would be left to the life insurance companies. This could prove to be a fatal double whammy for them, as average life expectancy may also rise to over 100 years of age. Life insurance companies will find themselves having to change the maturity dates of their policies. Assuming that passing into the next world will no longer happen so easily and that we will be able to live until the age of 100, it is logical to suggest that both the structure of this world and mankind's basic philosophy will probably have to change. Those patients covered by cancer insurance who have gone on to beat cancer through supermineral treatment will be happy fellows, as they will be able to turn down the meaningless anti-cancer drugs, rejuvenate their moods, and will clearly be all smiles as they freely use their insurance payouts as pocket money. Taking out an insurance policy and subsequently being diagnosed with cancer leads to an unconditional insurance payout to the policyholder. In the early stages of cancer, when surgery is completely unnecessary, it is a no-lose situation for the patient. I have seen countless numbers of such lucky people. The patients themselves regard these payouts as gifts from heaven, and so, coupled with the treatment they seek in superminerals, their happiness becomes a true joy. With the progress that has been made in medicine and science, the emergence of a problem that can rock the foundations of the scientific world is the last thing one expects. Yet an error so basic it can be compared to the pressing of the wrong button has occurred. A fundamental bug or mistake has crept into scientists' reasoning process, and with it the misfortunes of mankind have been amplified. In Europe, America, and also in Japan, modern-day diseases have gradually become more and more widespread. Even though the greatest cause of this spread is the deficiency of trace minerals, for some reason the focus has gone askew, resulting in a misdiagnosis. Secondary factors such as carcinogens, smoking, lack of exercise, overeating, and an irregular lifestyle have mistakenly been identified as the number one factors. So, with this approach, even curable illness became incurable. Scientists have gone out of focus at this point. As a result, the mineral deficiency, the loss of nutritional balance, has become widespread in advanced countries and moreover is looking to extend its damage into the countries of the developing world. Trace elements should have been called gene minerals. Look at table salt that can be seen with the naked eye. It is quite easy to use a weight gauge and accurately measure the mass to 0.1 gram or 100 milligrams. When attempting to measure something smaller than table salt, we use chemical balance scale. To measure the amount of an element contained in a substance, it has become common practice to use an instrument that measures the rate of light absorption of atoms of that particular element. This apparatus is used, for example, for measuring the sodium content as a chemical element in seawater. However, when it comes to measuring the mass of uranium contained in seawater, this becomes more difficult a task, and both the cost and the time involved will increase tremendously. It is because of this that the question of whether or not to measure the amount of trace elements contained in a plant or animal really comes down to, is it worth it? Because our scientific predecessors never placed much importance on measuring the quantity of trace elements, it has thus far remained an uncharted area. Even now, there exists very little recognition of the discovery of the genetic function of trace elements. Their presence has come to be ignored. The amount included in gases, liquids, and solids is only occasionally measured when a problem occurred. That's the story, and hence the amount of trace elements included in plants and animals has been overlooked. Not even an attempt has been made to measure them. Finally, however, we seem to have reached a turning point with the advent of the ICPM's measuring device. For 20 million yen, about a little less than $200,000, with 50,000 yen's worth, about a little less than $500, of argon gas, it has now been made possible to easily measure even the smallest amount of trace elements contained in any substance. This marvelous piece of equipment, the ICPM's gauge, went on the market a mere 3 years ago. Trace elements will soon become the savior of the day. It is no exaggeration to say that mankind has set forth upon a new scientific path thanks to this instrument, ICPM's gauge. On Earth, there exists water from ancient times. Preserved in the ice of Siberia and the South Pole, there is an abundance of life forms and lifeless matter. It is thought that if a thorough investigation of the land and sea were conducted, the accurate data obtained from analyses of the amounts of trace elements would lead to a fresh outpouring of many important scientific works. In the field of nutrition, a tremendous difference in the amount of minerals contained in organic produce compared to inorganically produced foods will come to light, meaning that agricultural scientists and doctors will likely have to atone for their oversight of these trace elements. Similarly, they will have to take responsibility for bringing about the huge occurrence of modern-day illnesses among mankind. It must be lamented that had more emphasis been placed on trace elements as gene minerals, then close to 80% of those who died from these modern-day illnesses could have been prevented. But even now, it's not too late. I hope that the importance of trace elements as gene minerals will be recognized as a new emergence to this world.